Jerry Brown's taxes will be defeated in 96 days.
Our state is in a real mess. We have to live within our means.
Don't shrink because you got a few little taxes. You know, suck it in.
Everybody's got to give a little. We want to raise everybody's taxes.
This is John and Ken's Tax Revolt 2012.
I was tired of hell, but I'm not going to take this anymore.
John and Ken Show, John Cobell and Ken Shampoo, Tax Revolt 2012, heads on a stick.
You're not kidding. All right, now we lead off with the story that Sacramento never learns its lesson. We have told you before, Jerry Brown's tax initiative, which you will vote no on, in November, is going to raise taxes on, quote, the wealthy, those that make more than $250,000 a year. In fact, if you make over $1 million, it's a breathtaking more than 13% personal income tax rate he's trying to get past. Now, why are we against this? Well, first of all, we're against tax hikes. Second of all, it is stupid to continue to rely on the wealthy for the bulk of your income tax collections. Over and over again, this has been demonstrated. Even the pundits that favor tax increases, the writers around California, say that this is stupid tax policy, but they never learn their lesson. Because why? Jerry Brown shows, he's shown the polls. Well, people are okay with taxing the rich.
People are largely stupid and ignorant. And it's counterintuitive to say that taxing the wealthy won't fix your budget problem. Because most people walk around and they think, well, the wealthy have so much money and there's so many wealthy people now, it must be easy to balance a budget just by taking it from them.
There's not enough of them. So when their incomes vary by large amounts, depending on whether investments are going, you get screwed. I don't know why people, that's too complicated for people. We have a joke on this show. It's called the 10-second rule. If you can't explain something on the air in 10 seconds, it's hard to do on the radio. However, I don't think that concept is really that hard to sink into people's brains.
You know, people
when you're relying on a very few taxpayers to pay the bulk of your income taxes and they have a bad year, you're screwed. I think I did that in 10 seconds.
Yes. Yeah, I bet people have a hard time believing it. And nobody explains this to them outside of us.
Because they're also led by like the Occupoosters into believing that there are millions and millions and millions of these people.
Well, yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of these Kardashians running around.
You hear that idea 100 times more than you hear our explanation. And we'll keep explaining this. And we're telling you the truth. This is not an ideological argument that the rich shouldn't pay. This is not about that. It's about the practicality.
Correct.
In a great year, during boom times, the way the California tax system is structured, the wealthiest pay 40 to 50% of all the income taxes in the state. Because once you get into high incomes, but that tax rate is a straight line up. It is a heavy tax that they're paying. But there aren't that many wealthy people out of 38 million. And there's fewer of them now than there were 5 years ago. There's fewer people making $1 million or more, or $500,000 or more. Many of these people earn their money through investments or real estate sales. And if the stock market crashes or the real estate market crashes, their income shrivels up. Now, maybe their lifestyle doesn't change for a few years because they've already pocketed a lot of money. But the money they pocketed, you can't tax.
Well, here are the numbers. The number of upper bracket taxpayers with $500,000 or more in annual income dropped by a third from 2007 to 2009, leaving fewer to tax. As of the 2009 tax year, California listed just 98,610 California tax returns with adjusted gross income of $500,000 or more, down 32.5% from 2007.
So you have one-third less people making $500,000 or more, and at the most, you have about 100,000. Now, you can't expect 100,000 people.
There's 38 million people in California.
Yeah, to finance the business of 38 million people. It's not practical. Now, this Facebook situation is a perfect microcosm of why this is bad policy.
And by the way, I wanted to point out one other thing about why this is bad policy, because we talked about how when these people, their income shrinks, you get screwed. Don't forget the flip side. When they have great years with big capital gains and the coffers are loading up like they did during the dot-com boom and a bit during the mortgage real estate boom, politicians in Sacramento, they budget like this money's going to come in forever. I mean, it actually hurts us both ways because they're idiots in Sacramento who, first of all, decide that, we're going to continue to ride this. And that's why Gray Davis handed out all those great pension deals. There were projections that the Dow was going to hit what?
$25 million
by the end of the century.
So there's two. It's a double-edged sword, and both edges have stabbed us in the back. During down times, the income for the wealthy drops significantly. All right, we have a third fewer people making $500,000 or more. Then, in good times, when it goes up, they budget as if the wealthy are going to be able to pay this amount in taxes forever. And it never happens. It's volatile. To have a stable taxation system, you would have to spread the income tax across all categories. Most people are still in the middle class. But we have an enormous amount of poor that we didn't used to have 20 years ago. We have a middle class that doesn't get taxed much until you hit $48,000 as a single. And then all of a sudden, you're paying the highest taxes in the nation at $48,000. It's really weird. But everybody paying less than $48,000 is hardly being taxed or not being taxed at all. It kicks in at $48,000, and then it goes really high once you get, past a million.
Which brings us to Facebook. And the reason we're even talking about this is that Facebook's share price continues to plunge. You may remember that the IPO, not that long ago, was priced at $38 a share. Facebook apparently dipped below $20 a share today.
1991 was the lowest price today. It rebounded slightly to just over $20.
So based on their latest share price, Sacramento is on track to get 47% less than it projected it was going to get for its budgeting.
They had projected $2 billion because they thought the price would be around $40. I'm rounding things off. They thought $40, $2 billion when the Facebook executives and the other investors start cashing in. Well, now it's at $20. So they've lost probably $1 billion.
Yep, they're claiming publicly hundreds of millions.
Yeah.
They're out of whack right now.
Well, right now, if it holds at $19, $20, it's dropped by roughly half compared to what they projected. So if they were projecting $2 billion, they're going to get $1 billion.
So another crisis for government, Governor Dementia.
This is exactly why you can't have a tax system that is tilted so heavily on the wealthy. Even if it makes you warm and fuzzy, even if you end up with very warm underwear, knowing that the wealthy are highly taxed, the wealthy don't make the same amount of money every year. They simply do not, especially if they rely on stock investments and real estate. Most people don't know it because they're not wealthy. I've known a few wealthy people, and it's true. I was shocked to find out how guys in real estate go from boom to bust, go from buying a huge freaking house, and 5 years later, they're frantically trying to sell it because all their construction projects were canceled.
Yeah, a lot of us just think about, salaries. You're employed by somebody, they pay you. But no, there's a lot of people that depend on investments.
No, and guys in real estate.
And if they're in their own business,
They're building a hotel here and a condo there. And they're developing, some suburban housing tract over here. And then comes the bust. And real estate is always boom and bust. All of a sudden, the investment money dries up. They're not building the housing tract in the suburbs. They're not building the hotel. The condo is half finished, and they're actually running out of town because they have built up a huge lifestyle buying the big house and the cars and all that, and now they don't have the income to pay the maintenance on all this. Once you create a high lifestyle, you have to keep making a lot of money every year to finance their lifestyle. We talked about Janet Jackson the other day. Yeah, she had a huge music career, and she's probably worth $100 million, but right now she hasn't had a hit in 10 years, and nobody comes to her tours anymore. So now she's got this big lifestyle. All she's doing is paying bills. There's not that much money coming in anymore. Maybe a modest stream from past hits, royalties. People still keep buying her music to some extent, but not the way it was 10 or 20 years ago. And so now she's got a lot more going out than coming in. And this is the way of wealthy people and celebrities. A lot of people that you think are fabulously wealthy probably were 10 or 20 years ago. But if they haven't had a hit record or hit TV show or hit movie in the last 10 or 20 years, they're shoveling way more money out than they're taking in. And they do that until they can't do it anymore.
All right. When we come back, before Governor Dementia, there was Governor Clown Hair, Arnold Schwarzenegger. And now he has his own think tank. We'll give you the details.
John and Ken Show. KFI AM 640, more stimulating talk radio.